Hi learner, welcome on board this session. The topic of this session is angle of attack. This particular topic is entitled to the subject flight mechanics. The target audience for this session are GATE aerospace aspirants, aeronautical and aerospace engineering students. We are following the GATE aerospace engineering syllabus of flight mechanics, and in this particular session we'll be focusing about angle of attack. To mention, the GATE Aerospace Engineering syllabus has been revised for GATE 2021. In the previous lesson, we did know about the primary flight instruments, and in this session, we will be seeing about angle of attack. We will also be gaining some insights about it, and further, we will be moving on to visualize the effect of angle of attack by using the software FoilSim, and we will be seeing the variation with respect to different airfoils. We will also be addressing a special question that why do we use airfoils instead of flat plates? Defining an angle of attack. Angle of attack is nothing but the angle between the relative wind and the chord line. So chord line is the line which joins the leading edge and the trailing edge of an airfoil. So relative wind, we need to know that relative wind, the wind which is relative to the airfoil or the aircraft, is known as relative wind. So here the angle of attack is abbreviated as AOA, and it is also replaced with the symbol alpha. So these both are commonly used in literature, and in some literature or in some instances, instead of chord line, an alternate reference line is also referred, such as in cases of a complete aircraft, instead of chord line, they use the middle line or the center line of the fuselage. Here we see a real case example. So this is a drone, and we can see the relative wind isn't horizontal. Instead, it is at some kind of angle. So the angle between the blue line, the relative wind, and the red line, the chord line or the center line of fuselage, is known as the angle of attack. Now, gaining some insights about angle of attack, one particular point to be noted is the unit conversion. As I mentioned angle, we will be using degrees, but in some instances you would be required to use radians. So this is the conversion methodology. So 1 degree times, when you multiply the degree value with pi by 80, you will obtain the radian value. Similarly, if you are having the radian value and if you multiply it by 180 by pi, the inverse of it, you will obtain the value in degrees. And another thing about angle of attack is that as you increase the angle of attack, the lift and drag considerably gets increased. And you also need to know that here is a star about, so the lift increase is subjected to the angle of attack. That means even though you increase the angle of attack, after some particular angle of attack or angle, the lift gets decreased. This particular point is known as stall. So this stall is a condition where the lift is lost. Here we also need to know that there is an angle of attack at which the lift is zero, and it varies based on the type of airfoil. So for symmetric airfoil, it is in the center, and that is at zero angle of attack. For cambered airfoil, it varies. So what about we visualize the effect of angle of attack on lift and drag? Let's visualize it by using NASA's foils. Let me switch over to Chrome for opening the software. So here I'm typing in FoilSim NASA. This is a software or applet by NASA. So this FoilSim student JS is basically used to investigate how an aircraft wing produces lift and drag. This can be obtained by changing the values of different factors that is affecting the lift and drag. So here I can show you about this particular portion. So here we can see that this is the software, and we are provided with some kind of inputs and output criteria. Basically, the unit is set to English units, and we are compatible with the metric units. So we are switching on over to the metric units. So here are a set of inputs and a set of outputs. And the inputs are indicated by blue color, and outputs are indicated by red color. And when we start to know about these inputs, at first we will be switching on or altering the flight inputs. So here we can alter the test condition, the speed, altitude, and similarly other things. As of now, I am using by default values. So here the speed is at 160 km per hour. As I increase the altitude, the density value and pressure value gets varied. Similarly, the temperature. Now the shape. So here I can also alter the shape of what I am visualizing. So the basic options provided are the symmetric and the cambered case. Similarly, flat plate, ellipse, and curved plate. Now getting on over to the analysis, you can always visualize the display. So here we are having quite few streamlines. Instead, you can obtain the moving streamlines, which is comfortable for me. You can always switch on over to whatever is comfortable for you. You can freeze at some particular point if you like to visualize. So this is in just 2D. We are basically generating or calculating for the 3D case. So this is a 3D case. Here we can see this is a wing for which we are calculating or altering the parameters and obtaining the results. So here is the 2D case or 2D view of it. And now the select plot. In this particular session, we are focusing on angle of attack and its effect on lift and drag. So basically, we are having options pressure, velocity, and drag polar. You can see the variation of it with the angle of attack. So here, I'm taking a non-dimensional value of lift, that is CL, and the angle of attack. So this is what we want, or we are focusing on to obtain. You can always alter the size, that is a chord length, so the length between the leading edge and the trailing edge, or span. And based on this, the aspect ratio is measured. So now getting on to the outputs, you can basically see the values which you are obtaining, such as the x by c value, the particular x location of this points or dots, and the y location of it, the y-axis location of these dots, similarly the pressure and the velocity. Now the data provides us with the airfoil shape, so what kind of airfoil we are using. So this is the Joukowsky airfoil, similarly the other parameters. We aren't concerned about the gauges, so gauge in particular provides you with the value of lift and drag. So here now we are plotting on the CL versus angle of attack. So here when we focus on the shape, so now we are getting into the topic. So here I'm taking a symmetric airfoil and the values as it is. So you can always vary the shape of the airfoil by varying the thickness to chord ratio. Here you can see when I increase the thickness to chord ratio, the airfoil bulges. So here I am considering the base value or the default value. So let me keep it as it is. So the symmetric airfoil. Well, the point we need to track is this orange particular point, and here we can see it varies with angle of attack. So as I vary the angle of attack, the CL value is plotted in the y-axis, and the angle of attack degrees is plotted in x-axis. So when I vary the angle of attack, the CL gets increased, and after a particular point, so here the lift can be noted, and after a particular point the lift starts to decrease. So this point after which the lift starts to decrease is known as the stall angle. And it is also interesting to know that after stall, the flow around the airfoil gets detached, which is clearly visualized by using the streamlines. So here when I shift on to decreasing the angle of attack, we can see the orange pointer over here. So the lift is getting reduced, and after which it is jumping into the other portion, that is, it is getting increased. So this is also the stall point. So basically, we can see that aircraft enter stall either if we increase the angle of attack too much or reduce the angle of attack too much. Now, it is also important to know that at zero angle of attack, the lift generated by a symmetric airfoil is zero. Now, when we switch on over to the highly cambered case or cambered case, you can see at zero angle of attack, it is generating some kind of lift. Now, let me alter this to zero angle of attack. So here, the airfoil is at zero angle of attack and it is generating about 12,932 newtons of lift. And when I increase the angle of attack, the lift gets increased up to a particular point and then it enters stall where it loses lift. So this particular region after stall is known as the stall region. So similar case is arrived by decreasing the angle of attack. And what about the flat plate? So here the flat plate is curved, so I am reducing the camber. You can see the reduction of camber over here. So when it is in zero angle of attack, it is generating zero lift, and when I increase the angle of attack, this flat plate is also generating some kind of lift. After this particular 15 degrees, the flow gets detached from the flat plate. So we can see that even I am able to generate lift by using a flat plate. So why don't we use flat plates instead of airfoil? So why is airfoil basically preferred over flat plates? What is the reason? Let's get to know about it. So here in flat plate case, we can see, so at zero angle of attack, the lift generated by a flat plate is zero. So here the efficiency is also zero. So this particular point is of interest as L by D ratio provides us with the aerodynamic efficiency. So how efficiently we produce lift is a factor. So this is basically calculated by the ratio of lift and drag. And once I increase the angle of attack, it is able to generate about 10,000 newtons of lift at around 14 degree angle of attack. But the point is that the flow has already detached. So what happens when the flow is detached is that you can see it isn't attached with the trailing edge. So basically our control surfaces will be in trailing edge, so it will be very difficult to control the control surfaces, similarly the airplane. Now when we switch on over to the case of symmetric airfoil, so I had similar to the case of flat plate, the symmetric airfoil also generates no lift at zero angle of attack. So the lift is zero at angle of attack zero. So here we can increase the angle of attack, and we can see at around 12 degrees, it is able to generate some kind of lift and with an aerodynamic efficiency of 8. Even though obtaining this kind of angle of attack is very difficult in real case, as it will be something like riding an inclined plate. So what is generally used airfoil, and what kind of airfoil can efficiently generate lift? So this is a point of interest. So in order to increase the lift generated with minimal variation in angle of attack and higher aerodynamic efficiency, we increase the camber of the airfoil. So once I increase the camber of the airfoil, you can see the effect of increasing camber. You can see at even zero angle of attack, I am able to generate some kind of lift. So here we can see at zero angle of attack, I am able to generate around 10,000 newtons of lift. So this is the effect of camber. So we basically introduce the camber in airfoil. But there is a fact with the L by D ratio, the amount of lift to drag ratio, the efficiency of generating lift. is varying with the camber. So this is why in aviation or in the aerospace industry, we generally prefer flat bottom airfoils. So flat bottom airfoil has minimal curvature in the bottom surface and the curvature increases on the upper surface. So here in flat bottom case, when I have a flat bottom case at zero angle of attack, the lift is around 4700 newtons, but the aerodynamic efficiency is 14.784. So that is, it is able to effectively or efficiently generate this particular amount of lift even at zero angle of attack. So if I require more lift, I can increase the angle of attack, and in general the angle of attack is only varied up to 10 degrees as the airplane stalls around 15 to 20 degrees in general. So it is going to alter based on the type of aircraft. So this is why we prefer an airfoil. So the major factor deciding is the L by D ratio, the aerodynamic efficiency, and the lift generated. And also, of course, the angle of attack. The minimal angle of attack which we have, the better it is. So this is why we use an airfoil instead of a flat plate. Now switching on over to the presentation, we did visualize the effect of angle of attack through NASA's FoilSim software. For gaining better knowledge on this topic, you can always refer the Introduction to Flight Literature, a book by J.D. Anderson, and the particular page numbers mentioned over here. The topic angle of attack is conveniently measured in all over the text of this book. In particular, this portions deal with better portion of it. So we have reached the summary portion of the session. We did know about angle of attack and we did visualize the effect by using FoilSim software. That's it for this session. Thank you.